Tav, and on behalf of my entire family, thank you very, very much for being here. All right, let's get this thing started right. God first, and here to give the blessing is His Excellency Bishop Gabriel Kassab, who will be introduced by Deacon John Jawad, who will be ordained a priest this fall. Let's hear it for him.
It truly is a pleasure to be with all of you tonight. The first year, 6 years ago, that dear Uncle Sam had this event, we were maybe 100 people, some veterans, some government officials. 6 years later, we are over 1,000 people. At the rate Uncle Sam is going, I think our next venue will be Little Caesars Arena. It truly is so beautiful to see everything Uncle Sam has done, him and his family. We thank them from the bottom of our heart for everything they are doing for our fallen heroes. It truly gives me a great honor and pleasure to introduce His Excellency Archbishop Gabriel Kassab, who is Archbishop Emeritus of Australia Oceania. Archbishop Kassab served in the mother homeland of Iraq for 50 years before becoming bishop. And while there, he served our community. He served all Iraqis without any distinction of faith or race, served them throughout all the different wars and all the different troubles that happened in our history. And he especially, as a spiritual father, served our U.S. soldiers who occupied Iraq. He heard their confessions. He did their masses. He was a spiritual father to every single person that came to his church. It truly is fitting that he is here with us today, not just because he is the relative of Sam Kassab, but also because he in his own way is a veteran. He in his own way served this great country by serving our heroes who are serving in Iraq. So we thank him for his service for the Chaldean Church, for all people in Iraq and in here in the United States. God bless him always. And we must remember all of our fallen heroes as we are gathered here today, who sacrificed their lives so that we are here today, living in this great country. In a special way, I want us to remember in this prayer all of our U.S. soldiers, all of our U.S. veterans who are currently and have served our country with courage, with bravery. It is because of you, brave men and women, that people like Bishop Gabriel, people like Sam Kassab and the Chaldean community are able to live in peace and freedom. It is because of your sacrifice and everything that you have given to our country that we are able to live in this peace. It is
USA! 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 USA!
It is because of men and women like these who are standing here that our villages were liberated from the hands of ISIS. It is because of you, brave men and women, that we are able to live in this country. But today, as we are gathered here in prayer, I ask that we also pray for the future of this country.
Yeah.
Amen. I ask that we also remember to include in our prayers, to plant in the hearts of our children what it means to be American.
Yes.
Because unfortunately, the America that Sam Kassab, that the Chaldean community came here in the 50s and 60s, is not the same America that they came to. We must pray and we must ask God to bless this country, to grant courage, to grant strength to all the leaders of this country, that the Holy Spirit may guide them towards truth, towards faith, towards hope, and towards love. So now let us implore and ask the Almighty God, and I ask you now to bow your heads as we ask His Excellency Archbishop Gabriel Kassab to give us his blessing, and he will impart his apostolic blessing using the cross that was given to him by the Saint Pope John Paul II.
أذيا وشريها اللي جمعت تنقادي شمت بابا وبلونا وروحت بتشال عالمين
آمين
God bless America
Amen
Now I would like to welcome to lead us in the Pledge of the Allegiance Please welcome to the stage Danny, Penelope, Danny, and Isaac, and Charbel, Kassab, and Azam. Give it up for the kids.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good job, kids. Thank you very much. And now, to perform our national anthem, we have someone very special for you. Put your hands together for Miss Christina Barr.
By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hail, had the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. Had the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag say, does that star-sprinkled banner wave? O'er the land of the free and the
something very special. I need a few friends up here to help me. I need Brian Rankin, I need Scott Marion, Ken Moore, John Motika, and Jack's mother, Sandra Huffman. If you're here, come on up. We got something very special. As they make their way to the stage, I will tell you a little story. For the last 60 days, Jack Huffman has walked nearly 1,800 miles. He started 2 months ago. He started in Sarasota, Florida. And he just got here within just a few minutes ago. Literally, he just got here. Now, before he left, he was tattooed by Elite Inc. Committee member John Motika over here. He was tattooed while Mark Casa was playing the Star Spangled Banner that powered the guitar. So he's infused with patriotism, literally. On this guy's journey, he jumped out of a plane. He went to a country boxing event. He's been a huge advocate for our mission. So I want to thank all the Americans who met Jack in his journey across this country, who fed him, who housed him, who gave him shelter. I want to thank Lowe's Home Improvement. They gave him tires for his wagon, food, water, supplies, places to sleep. And he's been collecting donations for this event, benefiting the Fallen and Wounded Soldiers Fund. And he's been uniting Americans together, one step at a time. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jack Huff.
For stepping up, showing their kindness and generosity to me all the way across America, through every neighborhood and community, and it's been just absolutely outstanding. And they have not only just shown the kindness and generosity, but shown how united we really are. And just thank you all. Thank you all so much for being here. I'd like to thank our veterans for giving me the chance to chase our dreams and keep pursuing that.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Bag full of money?
Bag full of money.
For the Fallen and Wounded Soldiers Fund? Make some noise for Jack Huffman. He brought a bag of money for the
Look at that.
All right, I don't know how much is in here, but it's heavy, so I imagine it's a lot. God bless you, Jack. Jack, don't go far. We got something for you. We want to give you a special plaque to say thank you for your walk across America. We are so honored. Can you take this bag of money? Thank you very much. We're so glad that you did it. Now, this is from the Salute Our Warriors Committee. We really appreciate everything you did. But I don't want you to go too far because I got something else for you. But before I do, I need to bring up a friend of mine. So ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the 77th President of the United States Conference of Mayors. He's currently the Vice President for the Global Parliament of Mayors. He's the Mayor of Rochester Hills, but his most important title, he's one of my best friends. Give it up for Mayor Brian Barnett.
President Jack, 1,800 miles and you saved the best for last. That's what I think.
Yeah.
Welcome to Rochester Hills, the home of, look at all these patriots out there. Can we give another round of applause, everybody? Yeah. We've been following your journey. We're so proud of you. We've watched everything that you've done. It's amazing that you have such a passion. You're surrounded by people that also have a passion for veterans. Yours is exceptional. I have not only this amazing plaque, which is a plaque, but more importantly, having watched what you've done, got some Rochester Hills sunscreen, sunglasses, and I don't know if you ever take any other transportation behind your feet, but besides your feet, but if you do, we've got Rochester Hills luggage tags. So congratulations on behalf of our committee. One more round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Reminds me to this day what is truly important, and as long as I am mayor of this city, we will proudly remember our veterans, honor our veterans, and for all times recognize where our blessings come from.
Amen.
To the men and women behind me, thank you. On behalf of a grateful city and a grateful nation, may God bless you, our veterans, your families, the city of Rochester Hills, and may God always bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Has anybody ever heard of Rosie the Riveter?
Yeah.
Rosie the Riveter is a cultural icon in the United States who represents the women who worked in the factories and the shipyards during World War II. The slogan of the Rosies is simple and strong, and their slogan is, "We can do it." Today we are honored to have some Rosies and some Rosebuds. Rosebuds are the daughters of the Rosies with us. So please give a warm round of applause. Original Rosie, Jean Zarenko is here. And original Rosie, Francis Masters is here. And give a warm round of applause to 21st Century Rosie, Kim Malai is here as well. So thank you to all the Rosies and all the Rosebuds. We love you all. Thank you for coming every single year. You guys make me so proud. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And now, to say a few words, please welcome your Oakland County Sheriff, Michael Bouchard.
Well, how do you follow what's already been said, other than say I'm towing all your cars? Just kidding, just kidding. Nobody gets a car towed and no one gets a speeding ticket while you're sitting here. You're welcome.
Yeah.
But to the Kassab family and the host committee for all that you have done, not just for the community, but for the men and women that serve our nation, thank you. It's important we remember and honor the people that gave their effort, their time, and sometimes their lives before us. But it's also important to encourage and instill that in our young people so we have a future generation of heroes. Yes. They're not meeting their quota in recruiting at all. So we need more patriots to look to the military and serve this country and continue to protect the values that these men and women handed us the baton. So it's time for that baton for all of us that have kids. I've done my part. We have two active duty. One is in the airborne, and he's on the quick reaction force for problems anywhere in the world right now. And the other's in the Air Force, so I can't recruit anymore. I don't think my wife wants to have any more kids, but I'll try. If I have to, I'll try. But I just want to say thank you to all of you for being here to support the effort that does recognize and support our heroes, that gave us the blessings that we have under the Lord. All of it comes from the Lord and the heroes that then defend what this country has given us. God bless you for being here, for supporting the heroes, and for doing what you're doing here tonight and every day. Thank you. Thank you.
host Sam Kassab.
I want to say thank you, our veterans. Thank you for your service. We honor you every day in my home.
Oh.
Thank you. I want to thank you all the supporters, everybody here that helped to make this event, all the volunteers, everybody else was here, how we can help. God bless you, all of you. God bless America. Keep supporting our veterans. That's all I ask.
And this bird traveled with Jack for 1,800 miles. Now it's time to send him home. Jack, send him home, brother.
So, just a couple quick examples of why we're here, okay?
The transition from military life back to a civilian life is almost like moving to a different country. And it can be hard. It can be really hard. It was hard for me. It was hard for a lot of the guys that I served with.
It is pretty hard to get a decent job when you get out. The medical issues are what caught up to me. It was going real bad real quick.
I had just found out that I had cancer and encompassed my brain, so there was no time to wait. I had a biopsy and suffered a stroke on my right side and lost most of the use of my appendages.
3 or 4 times a week, I'm up at the hospital seeing somebody for something that was military related. It was causing a big problem with any kind of employment.
After being out of work for that long, anybody's gonna be in some hardships. There is a lot of times of dark moments where you sit up late at night knowing that you can't take care of the person that you love. Some days you stay awake all night feeling super depressed and feeling completely worthless. It's awful.
All the time that I spent in the military protecting this country wasn't enough to help my family.
Being able to ask for help is hard. I know myself that I have a lot of pride, and it's hard to be able to stick your hand out, so to speak.
My wife and I really were suffering some hardships, and we contacted probably over 15 to 25 different organizations before we found the Fallen and Wounded Soldier Fund.
Without the Fallen and Wounded Soldiers Fund, my family would have lost everything.
I think this was about 2 years ago when I first learned of them. So they took care of everything, and we couldn't be more grateful.
They're very respectful towards soldiers and do what they can to make sure that we're taken care of, regardless of our situation.
I just couldn't believe that somebody was actually willing to help us out after months of trying to reach out to different people. It was one of the best feelings in the world. I remember calling my wife and telling her about it, and she just started to cry.
If it wasn't for the Fallen and Wounded Soldiers Fund, we probably wouldn't be able to have the sense of security that we have day to day and be able to give that to our children. They are there for the veterans.
I thank them with the bottom of my heart, and my family does too.
They're truly a blessing.
If you're looking to give and if you're looking to help, the Fallen and Wounded Soldiers Fund is the organization to donate to.
I wish I had better words. I finally got to meet Lynn last weekend. I've never really wanted to hug somebody else more. She's been an angel the whole time. It's really, there's not many words. It's just amazing.
We get a call within 24 hours, they get called back. Within a week, we can help them or we seek other help for them and we can make a determination. So this is what you all are contributing to, and from the bottom of our heart, thank you so much. Walk away proud of what you're doing because you've helped out for several months. Thank you so much. Specialist Robert James Hogan, United States Marine Corps, Vietnam. Robert James Hogan was born in Detroit, Michigan in 1944. He graduated high school, and at that time there was a draft, so people weren't hiring guys his age because they figured they were going to get drafted away.
So he volunteered to serve his country in the Marine Corps. He served from 1963 to 1967. He went through boot camp and teletype school in California, was stationed in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. Next, went on to Okinawa, Japan, was promoted to Sergeant E5 and Message Center Chief. After his honorable discharge, his former officer told him of a printing company that was hiring, and he worked at the Safran Printing Company, then at Laughlin Steel Corporation, where he met his lovely wife. After that, he applied for a challenging job at Masco Corporation. He worked for 30 years. He also earned his college degree from Macomb Community College and his bachelor's degree from Walsh College. In addition to working full-time, going to college, he was also a single parent raising two beautiful daughters on his own who turned out to be successful women of all because of him, and they'll tell you that. So let's give it up for Specialist Robert James Hogan, United States Marine Corps.
Volunteering was an honor and a privilege. It was back then, and I do it again, and it's still an honor and a privilege.
Oh.
I just love this country and wouldn't change one thing.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our second honored veteran today, Sergeant Jorge Javier Medina, U.S. Army, Vietnam. Jorge Medina was born and raised in, if I say it right, Jalisco, Mexico. After his mother passed away, he moved to California to live with family. Sergeant Medina joined the Army in 1965. He was sent to Germany with an armored unit, where he earned the rank of E5 and promoted to sergeant as a tank commander. He then was sent to Vietnam as a member of the 101st Airborne, where he served as an aircraft electrician. Sergeant Medina met his wife while stationed for a short time in Michigan and returned to raise a family after the war. It should be noted that the 101st, now this is love and loyalty. It should be noted that the 101st offered Sergeant Medina $10,000 to stay 6 more months, but since he got married, he said no. Give it up for Sergeant Jorge Medina, U.S. Army, Vietnam.
So I just want to bless the good Lord and bless my whole entire family and bless all these people that are here for us. And may God bless you. Amen.
Thank you.
Our third honored veteran this evening is Corporal Robert Bailenda, U.S. Army Korean War, 1952 to 1954. Corporal Bailenda was born in Detroit, where he lived until he was drafted in 1952 while the Korean War was raging. At age 19, he was sent to Korea, attached to the 453rd Combat Engineering Battalion in Busan, Korea, where he served with Company D that transported heavy equipment to the front lines. Corporal Bailenda also helped build huts and supported the oil, gas, and airfields on the front lines at Incheon. The war ended 40 days after his arrival, and he stayed in Korea for 16 months serving post-war duties. Corporal Bailenda earned several medals, including the Korean Service Medal with Bronze Star, National Defense Service Medal, Republic of Korea Presidential Unit Citation, Meritorious Unit Commendation, and the Ambassador for Peace Medal, Korea. After the war, Corporal Bailenda returned to Detroit and took advantage of the GI Bill, went to college in the medical field, and in 1961, he met his lovely wife, Eleanor, who moved from Poland to work at the same medical lab he managed. So here again is an example of love.
He didn't hire her. She came to work at that lab. He didn't hire her. He married her instead. So please give it up to our good friend and fellow patriot, Corporal Robert Belinda.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that next week, July the 27th, is the 70th anniversary of the signing of the Korean Peace Treaty. And those who did not make it, those who gave the supreme sacrifice, that their blood and soul is buried right there in the red, white, and blue of the American flag of the United States of America.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
And our fourth honored veteran this evening is Specialist E5, Joseph Mishler, U.S. Army, Vietnam. Specialist Mishler was born in Big Rapids, Michigan, and he was attending college when he was drafted in 1966. After basic and advanced infantry training, he arrived in Vietnam in March of 1967. He was assigned to the 4th Platoon B Company, 423rd Mechanized 25th Infantry Division as a gunner, with an 81 millimeter mortar unit. E5 Mishler saw action in the Iron Triangle, Boloy Woods, various plantations, the Black Virgin Mountains, and around Ku Chai. E5 Mishler was wounded in action twice. First, when his APC hit a mine, then came under fire while waiting to be repaired. E5 Mishler was severely wounded on June 5th, 1969, near Sukhoi. During a bombardment, he was injured in his hands, arms, and head. After spending 4 months in an army hospital in Japan, he was reassigned to Seoul, Korea to complete his military service. Specialist Miller was awarded numerous medals, including 2 Purple Hearts, the Combat Infantry Badge, the Vietnam Campaign Medal, the Vietnam Service Medal, and was honorably discharged in 1968. He still suffers permanent disability due to the effects of Agent Orange. After the war, Sergeant Mishler returned home to his hometown, Holly, Michigan. He received a Bachelor's of Arts degree, was a teacher at Holly Area Schools, a historian, a public speaker, an author, a storyteller, a researcher. Joe has directed and produced over 120 plays and musicals, including a play about the Vietnam Veterans Memorial funded by a creative arts grant from the state of Michigan. Joe is married to his lovely and also talented wife, Linda, where they reside in Holly, and also a very dear friend of mine. Let's give it up for Specialist E5, Joseph Mishler. This is truly a pleasure, and it's a great evening to see so many patriots in one place. We need a lot more of that in this country.
Yes,
and we need a lot more people serving our country.
Yes.
So God bless America.
Yeah. Private First Class Essa was on the beaches at Normandy and witnessed General George Patton land with his army for the big breakthrough. PFC Essa was wounded in battle and earned numerous medals and honors while fighting in Europe, Africa, and the Middle East, including the Purple Heart, the Combat Infantry Badge. He was injured severely, and while recuperating, Private First Class Essa wrote a very powerful letter home. Now let me share with you just how powerful that letter was. It was selected as one of 8 that was shared by Ted Koppel on Nightline. It was published by the Legacy Project in Washington, D.C. and the New Yorker magazine. Don't you all want to read that letter?
Yes.
I do. I'm going to find that when I leave here, sir. I'm going to read that letter. That's our homework tonight. Private First Class Essa lives in Michigan,
with his lovely wife, Samira, where they raised their five children. Mr. Peter Essa is a proud Chaldean-American patriot who, like our other heroes tonight, risked everything for his country and his fellow soldiers. Ladies and gentlemen, please honor Private First Class U.S. Army World War II, Peter Essa. He insisted on walking. Thank you, sir.
I would like to thank Sam Zayed for this wonderful event. It was a great honor serving in World War II. Thank you to all our veterans and my family. God bless you, Peter Essa. Woo!